Hey everyone, Lucas here. Glad to be bringing our next part in our Heroes of Faith series. I want to thank Dave Phillips for bringing us our first Hero of Faith. I believe it was Itai, and did a great job. And today we're going to be looking at Daniel. And what I wanted to do, and I think is a good theme, is to look at Daniel and do a character study. This is slightly different. In that, what I want to do today is really look at the situation, the scenario, all of the events that happened that really affected the character of Daniel, really shaped him as a person, and the things that he did and did not do. So that's going to be a big subject for today. So we're going to be looking at Daniel, and we're going to look at Daniel chapter 1. There's several stories that we could look at, and I want to encourage you to continue reading. Keep reading the book of Daniel. It is such a great book. And but I've chosen for the sake of time to just look at Daniel chapter 1 and do a character study on just the events that happened to Daniel during this chapter. We're going to do a good bit of reading, so if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn there to Daniel chapter 1. Let's go ahead, jump in, let's start reading. It begins, "In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and placed the vessels in the treasury of his God. Then the king commanded Ashpenaz, his chief eunuch, to bring some of the people of Israel, both of the royal family and of the nobility, youths without blemish, of good appearance and skillful in all wisdom, endowed with knowledge, understanding, learning, and competent to stand in the king's palace, and to teach them the literature and language of the Chaldeans. The king assigned them a daily portion of the food that he ate and of the wine that he drank. They were to be educated for 3 years, and at the end of that time they were to stand before the king. Among these were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah of the tribe of Judah. And the chief of eunuchs gave them names. Daniel he called Belteshazzar. Hananiah he called Shadrach. Mishael he called Meshach. And Azariah he called Abednego." So let's stop there. So much has happened here in these few short verses. I would argue months have passed since verse 1 to verse 7, several months have passed. A lot is going on. Nebuchadnezzar has come down to Judah. He has captured it. He has taken away some of the people. He has taken away the king. He has taken away some of the vessels that were in the house of God. And one of those characters, one of those people who was captured was Daniel. Daniel being captured by Nebuchadnezzar in the year 605. Jerusalem has not fallen just yet. It's not been destroyed. That'll be later. But in this episode here, Daniel has been captured. And I want to just let everyone know that Daniel was captured as a youth, it says. He was a youth, and really what that means is he was a teenager. He was young. I'm not talking about 18, 19, 20. I'm talking about 13, 14, 15. He was somewhere in that age range, maybe a little bit older. But he was a teenager. He was a youth when he was captured. And even though he was one of the nobles, of a noble family, he would have seen a lot. I mean, this is war we're talking about. And the things he would have witnessed were probably horrifying. I mean, really, things that you don't forget for the rest of your life. And there's no need to go into the details, but just know that at the age of 13, 14, maybe, he saw a lot of things. Things that we, thank the Lord, have never seen. Most of us, at least. But he, Daniel, even at a young age, a lot has happened in his life. A lot of bad things, but you know, some good things, too. And we're going to look at that as well. We don't know much about Daniel, his early life. We don't know much about his parents, his family, but he probably never saw them again. They're never mentioned. But Daniel was taken north. He was taken north and then southeast around the Arabian desert. So north and southeast, far away from the land of Judah. Very much a foreign land, very different land. He was taken to the land of Babylonia, to the city known as Babylon. And I'm sure he'd heard about them. I'm sure he'd heard rumors and just in conversation, but I'm sure he didn't really understand the Babylonians. He didn't understand what their culture was like and you know, their language, things of that nature. And so we're talking, you know, within a week, Daniel's whole life changed. It was very different. And I bring up this picture here, this on this PowerPoint. This is a reconstruction of one of the gates of Babylon. They had 8 strong, fortified gates, each of them better than the last, each of them named after one of their gods. And the most famous one is the gate of Ishtar, one of their gods. And it's an amazing gate. And this is not the gate of Ishtar, but it's one of the smaller gates, actually. And if you look, you can see there's a man, or there are several people there at the bottom of the screen. And if you say they're 6 feet tall, maybe, that's kind of tall. We'll say 5'11". And you can probably fit 4 or 5 men who are 5'11 to reach the top of this gate. I mean, this gate is huge. It's massive. It's fortified. It's strong. And the neat thing about this reconstruction is that they took actual clay blocks. These blue blocks here, these colored blocks, some of them, many of them, are from Babylon. They reconstructed here. This is in Germany. And that they reconstruct a museum there, a Pergamum Museum, I think. And really, I bring this up because this is one of the first things that Daniel would have seen upon entering the land, the city of Babylon. And what an intimidating sight it must have been, going through gate after gate after gate, each one better than the last, finally coming upon the gate of Ishtar. And you see on the side of this gate, let's go to the next one, there's all these illustrations, that's not the right word, but there's all these carvings, I guess. And at the top there, you see those are supposed to be dragons. There's dragons on this gate. And then on the bottom here, they're bulls, dragons and bulls. And they represent the gods, and they represent power and might, strength, the strength of the Babylon people and their gods, Babylonian people and their gods. And I can't help but imagine that Daniel would have been very lonely. It would have been a long trip from Judah all the way up and around to get to Babylon. And I imagine it wasn't comfortable. I imagine he would have been scared. He would have been afraid. He was 13. Of course he was. I imagine he was quiet. He was nervous, trying to figure out what's going to happen. What's going to happen to me, my friends who are with me? Because as we're going to find out, he had 3 friends there with him. And so finally arriving at the city, he would have been even more nervous going through all of these gates with these soldiers, even more nervous seeing all of these carvings, these illustrations, this might of Babylon. Would have been more nervous. And I like Daniel so much because he had a lot of decisions to make. A lot of decisions, because he's away from his family, for all we know. He has a few friends, sure, but he's away from his family. He's away from the leaders of his time. He's away from religious leaders, political leaders. There are no leaders anymore. So he's, at the age of 13, having to make a lot of decisions for himself. So that's why I bring up these pictures. Just, it's amazing because Daniel would have seen these very same carvings, these very same bricks that we're looking at today. And it's also sad to read that everything that was unique to these men, their Judean culture, their language, their clothing, even their names, was stripped from them. And they were given new lives, new identity, a new culture to live by, new lifestyle, all of these things. Who they were was they were was stripped from them, or there was an attempt to strip whoever they were before away. They would now be Babylonian. And the Babylonians did this. They did this often. They would go, they would conquer a land, take anyone who's in charge, anyone in authority, and either kill them or bring them to Babylon. Because if there's going to be an uprising, guess who's going to start the uprising? Okay? Or let me rephrase that. Guess who's going to lead the uprising? It's the nobility. Yeah, they're the ones that are going to lead this uprising against Babylon, the local nobility. So what do? You take the local nobility away. And you take them, you put them in a new land, give them a new job, a new position, and hope that they kind of assimilate. That's the goal, assimilation. And then you're just left with the local people, the workers there in the land, and you hope and you try to put down any insurrection that happens there. So Daniel is taken along with Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah. They are taken, they are selected to be trained in the arts with the hopes that they might one day become useful to their new king. And at the end of this three-year education, the end of this three-year training, hopefully they would be skilled in the language, culture, and lifestyle of this polytheistic society. And having witnessed the destruction, the violence of the war that happened in Judah, I'm sure they had many negative feelings toward Babylon. But at the same time, I'm sure they felt grateful to be in a place where they were considered valuable, where they had all their needs provided for, where there was peace, where they were given respect and authority, power even. And so I'm sure they had these conflicting feelings. But when we continue looking at chapter 1, beginning in verse 8, we see that even though the Babylonians tried to strip them of everything they were before, the Babylonians couldn't get rid of everything. Verse 8 says, "But Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with the king's food." The king wanted Daniel to assimilate, to become one of the people. But Daniel, it says he's resolved. He has strength. He has this might where he stands up and says, "No, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to defile myself by eating food that is not kosher," we would say. Food that is acceptable for Jewish people. And he would not do it with the wine that the king drank either. And so he asks, verse 8, "The chief of the eunuchs to allow him not to defile himself. Please, don't force me to do this." And in verse 9, God gave Daniel favor and compassion in the sight of the chief of the eunuchs. And the chief of the eunuchs, in verse 10, said to Daniel, "I fear my lord the king, who assigned your food and your drink. For why should he see that you were in worse condition than the youths who were your own age? So he would endanger my head with the king." And then Daniel, he's smart, he's thinking quick, and he says to the eunuch who had been assigned to him, "Test your servants. Here's what we'll do. We'll test, give us a test. For 10 days, let us be given vegetables to eat and water to drink. And then let our appearance and the appearance of the youths who eat the king's food be observed by you. And deal with your servants according to what you see." So in verse 14, the eunuch listened to them in this manner and tested them for 10 days. And at the end of 10 days, it was seen that they were better in appearance and fatter in flesh than all the youth who ate of the king's food. So in verse 16, the steward took away their food and wine that they were to drink and gave them vegetables. Now, I know some of you are probably thinking, "Lucas, what? This story is boring. It's not that great." No, you're supposed to look at Daniel in the lion's den, right? Well, I kind of looked at this Daniel chapter 1 on purpose, and I looked at it because I wanted to look at Daniel's very beginnings, because I wanted to look at Daniel, who was 13 years old, who made such great decisions, who was smart, who had at the age of 13, 14, 15 maybe, who had wisdom, more wisdom than maybe I would have. Because the king says, you will eat this. And Daniel, who's quick on his feet, who knows that this is not a good idea, this is a bad idea for me, I should not eat this. And he says, well, let's have a test. You know, first he asks the eunuch, says, please don't make me eat this. And when the eunuch kind of pushes back, he says, okay, well, let's do a test. And they do this test, and the test is smart. That's a smart thing to do. Because Daniel knows that the right thing to do is to follow God, and God is only going to require of us what is good. And so he says, you know, you should eat kosher meat. And there's all these laws, these food laws, that I'm not going to get into today. It's really in depth, and there's lots of great things that go along with that. So Daniel doesn't want to betray God by betraying these kosher laws. He knows that these kosher laws are good. And so he says, you know, let's do a test. And they do. And of course, they find that it's better to eat vegetables and drink water than it is to gorge yourself with meat and wine. Okay? And we, you know, thousands of years later, we would even agree that's not a good idea. That's a bad idea. But what's amazing about Daniel and his three friends, and Daniel specifically who asks about this, is that even though he was stripped of everything that was unique and special to him, the one thing that the Babylonians couldn't take from Daniel was his faith in God. They couldn't take that away from him, his faith, his desire to follow God. And it's amazing that for 3 years, they were immersed in Babylonian culture. They were separated from their people, their religious leaders. They were spoiled, you could say, with as much wine and food as they could eat, every need of theirs supplied. But the one thing that they never lost was their faith in God. They could have assimilated and gone along with the Babylonian culture. And maybe to some degree, they did. You know, I'm sure they said, okay, we will wear your clothes. Okay, we will learn your language. Okay, we will learn your culture. But that doesn't mean we have to take part in it and make that our culture. Daniel and his friends were men of integrity. They were men of integrity, and during a time when it would have been much easier to go with the flow, to not make waves, to do what you have to do to survive. No, Daniel and his friends chose to keep their integrity. It would have been easier for Daniel to say, it's not a big deal for me to eat meat that isn't kosher. Of all the things that are going on, you know, I'm just going to eat this meat. That's not that big of a deal. I'm just going to eat it. He could have said, I have much bigger things to worry about. But it's remarkable that even with faced with the smallest of ethical, of religious, of these dilemmas that are a part of his integrity, that mess with his integrity, such as what food to eat. I mean, this would seem to maybe some of us to be such a small, insignificant little thing to make such a big deal about. But it's because Daniel has this integrity that he says, I'm not even going to budge an inch when it comes to my integrity, when it comes to my faith in God and following the practices, the laws that he has laid down for me. I'm not going to budge an inch. It would be easy to say, well, it's just food, but he doesn't. It would be easier to say, well, there's bigger things to worry about, but he doesn't say that because he wants to keep his integrity intact. Daniel is a man of integrity. His friends are men of integrity. And integrity means to be of sound moral principle, to be upright, to be honest. It means that you do what is right when no one is looking, or that you do what is right when no one else cares. And I think that's so valuable for us today, because in a society like ours, which is very accepting of all thoughts, of all beliefs, of all attitudes, in a society like ours, it's easier than ever to betray one's own personal integrity, one's faith, belief, the statutes that we see of God, that he has given us. It's easy to betray that. And for people to say, in this culture that we live in, that's okay. That's okay. And it's easy when it seems like everyone is going in a certain direction to just abandon the ethical principles that we see in Scripture, to abandon the statutes that we see in Scripture, the doctrine, the teaching that we see in Scripture. It's easy to abandon that and just go with the flow. Just say, it's easier to do this. You know, everyone's doing it. You know, that old saying. And then if you're a parent, you've probably said, well, if everyone's jumping off a bridge, do you jump off a bridge? You know, I'm joking around. But that is the easiest thing to do, especially in our society today when there's so much pressure to go with the flow, to do what everyone else is doing. It's easy to betray one's personal integrity. It's easy to betray our Christian walk for the sake of peace. And so I wanted to mention Daniel today because he is such an important character. And I wanted to look at this character study of all that happened to him and how even amidst all of this pain, this struggle, this turmoil, this new culture, this new life that he was given, they still couldn't take away his personal integrity, this relationship that he had with God. He kept that. He held on to that. And I think that's so inspiring for us today. And so I want to leave us with this passage of 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 1 through 5, where it says here, "Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking, for whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God." Verse 3. "For the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, lawless idolatries. With respect to this, they are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery, and they malign you. But they will give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead." I leave us with this passage because it's from a New Testament book about assimilation and assimilating into the culture in the midst of persecution, when it would be easier to just go with the flow and to assimilate. Peter is saying, no, 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 you have left that behind you. That's what you did when you were a Gentile. But you are a Gentile no longer. You have put those things, that previous life of yours, to death. And you've taken on a new life. And so people are going to malign you when you say, no, I don't do that anymore. They're not going to like it when you don't do that anymore. But this is good. This is the new life that you have been given. You have this flesh that you now have, this life, this body that you now have is free from sin. So live according to the will of God. My friends, I love you and I appreciate you. I hope that was helpful. I love looking at the story of Daniel. If I said David at any time today, I apologize. Daniel and David are just so easy to say. But anyways, people, I love you. I appreciate you. I hope this was helpful. And please tune in next time for another devotional series. I know it's going to be great. Thanks.